Ada Yonath es químico y máster en bioquímica de la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén. Obtuvo su doctorado en cristalografía de rayos X en el Instituto Weizmann de Ciencias y sus postdoctorados los realizó en Estados Unidos. Fue pionera en el estudio sobre la estructura de ribosomas. En 2009, fue galardonada con el Premio Nobel de Química. Durante más de dos décadas, ha desentrañado el modo de acción de los antibióticos, abriendo nuevas posibilidades para la cura de enfermedades. A continuación, de la ciencia básica a los avances en la medicina antiinfecciosa y la preservación del microbioma.
Good morning. First, I want to thank you for inviting me here and for showing me the movie that I'm the star of it. Never saw something like this. Thank you very much. Second, I was asked to give a general public lecture. So I'm apologizing for those that what I will tell is completely known, at least in the beginning. And I also apologize for those that it will look a bit too difficult. I try to do my best. So I'm a basic scientist, and I wanted to understand the basic process of life, and was very lucky that immediately, once I got my first discovery, I also could go into advanced medicine. It doesn't happen to everybody that basic science become useful and applicable right away. And I want to share with you this story. So for those of you that know that proteins are very needed, we eat steaks and eggs and cheese, but actually they are very needed because they are doing almost all functions of living cells, from bacteria to humans. What you see here are some examples of proteins, human proteins, and what they do. So the first are the enzymes, those that are chopping the food that we eat in order to use the components of this food to make the proteins that we need. We need proteins for our senses, for instance, for seeing, for our body, skin, hair. These are the structural proteins. For signaling and regulatory, to make sure that in every organ, the supply of materials is regulated, like insulin, for instance. For transport, like hemoglobin, that transports oxygen from the lung to the muscles, which are also proteins. So here are only a few examples for proteins that essentially perform almost all cellular functions. As I said, in all cells, in bacteria, in cockroaches, in flowers, and also in human. So if we talk about human, those required for smooth life, like you saw a minute ago, breathing, digestion, muscle motion, and those responding to pressure. So there are proteins that are helping us to respond to heat or cold shocks, to immune. The immune response is also done by proteins. Organ failure, even heart. Sometimes a patient can take care of himself or herself when the heart is failing. These are two proteins, two enzymes. Dust in the eye, let's talk about this for a minute. If dust comes to the eye, we get tears. Not because we are sad, but because the tears are washing out the dust. But not only washing out, it's not just water. The tears are salty, and there is inside one protein, an enzyme, that can cut the walls of all bacteria. So this is more than just cleaning. This is preventing infections that could have come with this if the dust has inside bacteria that can cause infections. In nature, there is a general rule that structure means function or function means structure. So you know this very complicated machinery that is called paper clip. These clips can hold together a few pages. But after one plays with them, like many nervous people are doing while sitting and talking, the same hooks have the same clips, have different structure, just structure. They were not boiled, they were not cut, they were not digested, nothing. Just different structure. And in this different structure, the different fold, they cannot make their task. They cannot fulfill their task to hold together a few pages. And this is correct in nature. And I want to show you in proteins. For those of you that are less acquainted with proteins, this is a molecule of a protein, a normal, typical enzyme, typical protein, that is made of many atoms. You have the names here, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, and sulfur. And it has an active site here. This, if you can see, there is here a curvature, and this is the active site. In order to see it better, I rotated it and enlarged it and focused only on this area. This is here. And this is the active site with the substrate. The substrate is this khaki thing, khaki and purple. So you can see that the active site accommodates the substrate exactly. If the substrate would be a little bit larger, it won't be accommodated. A little bit smaller, it will be floppy. So the action of this enzyme, which is chopping here, would not be correct. And nature tries to prevent cases like that. There are about 25,000 different types of proteins in a normal human adult, in the body of a normal human adult. Each of the 100,000 billion cells in human bodies contains around a billion protein molecules, and they are produced constantly according to the needs of the cell, and also in order to keep fresh proteins as fast and as good as we can. Proteins are long chains of their components, which are called amino acids. There are 20 types of amino acids. I won't describe them chemically now, just you know that there are 20 types, and I'll show something about them in a minute. And the fold of each protein, which is carefully designed for fulfilling its function, is determined by the sequence of the amino acids building it. So proteins are about long chains of about 200, 300 amino acids, and there are 20 types of them. So let's look at it for a minute. I drew a typical amino acid here. These are five typical amino acids, five out of the 20. They all have the same backbone, like in puzzle. Same, although the color is different, but the shape is exactly the same. And each has a different side chain. Many side chains, most of the side chains, give the protein, give the amino acids its chemical nature, and some can serve as tools, as biochemical tools. The proteins are polymers, long chains of these amino acids, so they come together. And here I was lazy, so I drew only the tools. They even go larger, several hundreds. So here I didn't even draw the tools, no detail, just long chains. And they can be useful only if they can fold correctly and create an active site, like here. So all of this was known when I started. But what was not known is how it is being done, how this process goes on, especially how this step is performed. How they know to come according to the sequence that they have to enfold and bind and fold. So that's what I wanted to understand, how they come together, this thing. Now, many people say, that, including myself, we had lots of doubts whether it's possible. It was supposed to be impossible because several very, very good groups tried to do it, to find it out and could not. So it was, the common knowledge was that it's not possible to know how this process goes on. And I doubted it too, but I had an idea that I thought was more different than the others, and I knew if we do it, we will have a real big smile. And this is what happened, and I feel that some of you are smiling with me now. So let's go back to what I said earlier, 20 types of amino acids, their sequence within the proteins, which enables their functionality, is dictated by the sequence of them, and what dictates the sequence, their sequence, the gene that codes for the protein. So I'm sure that you all know the word gene now. These are the pieces of the DNA. So actually, the DNA is a string of instructions. Each gene is instructions that each gene is coding for one protein, and this instructions are written in four-letter language. Ladies and gentlemen, all our life, not only us, all life is coded by only four letters. This is the whole language of life, much more than any book you ever read. Four-letter language in which each three letters, or three bases it's called also, are coding for a specific amino acid. So each amino acid out of the 20 has three letters that code for it. These are called codons. So just a little drawing. You all know that this is the DNA structure. These are the bases, the letters. You can see only four colors. You can see that they make pairs. We won't discuss this now. But each three of them, let's say these three or these three, are coding for a specific amino acid. Here, the information is embedded in a helix, a double helix, that protects it. It's not available. So what happens when a gene has to be translated? The DNA that you can see here in the double helix is being transcribed to a very similar molecule called RNA. RNA has also only four letters. Three of them are exactly like DNA. One is quite similar. And it can exist as a single helix. It doesn't have to be a double helix. Therefore, the information here is available. This particular RNA is messenger RNA because it has the message that was in the gene. This can be translated to the growing protein in a machinery, cellular machinery, called the ribosome. So this is what I wanted to understand, this part. Not that this part was easy, but clear. When we started, this was also not clear. But in 2006, Professor Roger Kornberg got the Nobel Prize for explaining this step. But we focused on that step. So we think that we can describe the ribosome. You see this machinery here that gets the instructions and makes proteins. We can describe it as a factory that gets the instructions here. These are how the protein will be looked. It's being read and decoded here. And when a triplet that codes for a specific amino acid comes here, the amino acid, which is brought by the truck into the factory, The TRAC is another molecule of RNA called transfer RNA, tRNA. The cognate amino acid is brought here and will be connected to the newly grown protein inside. Then, at the same time, the instructions will move by one triplet, progress, and the TRAC that carried the amino acid will go out empty. The protein will be longer by one amino acid. And the whole process needs some energy, which I drew as a chimney output. The ribosomes are universal, which, what I mean, there are small ribosomes in bacteria, larger ribosomes in human, in every organism according to its position in evolution, but doesn't matter what it is, all function in a very similar way. Maybe exactly the same way. It means all decode the information, the genetic information, and all make the bond, the peptide bond, the same way, very similar, maybe the same, regardless of the source. There is a huge number of ribosomes that function in each living cell. Mammalian cells may contain millions of ribosomes, millions in one cell. Each bacterial cell can contain up to 100,000 ribosomes. They act very fast, continuously and fast. They can form up to 40 bonds that connect the amino acid with the growing protein, 40 in a second, and hardly make mistake. One mistake in a million bonds. And this is what we can measure. Maybe they make more, but they get rid of it. They have a proofreading machinery that get rid of their mistakes before we catch them. I just want to tell you about myself, a personal note. I was a very good student and very fast student. And in second grade in the university, I was asked to make a peptide bond, one single peptide bond. It took me 6 hours. They can make 40 in a second. In the book that I got the instructions from, it says 50% mistake is tolerable. They have one in a million. Now chemistry developed, and one can do in the lab peptide bonds much quicker, 2 hours instead of six, but not 40 in a second. So instead of talking much, I want to show you a movie. Oops, sorry. I cannot start for some reason. Sorry. Again. Oh, now it starts. That we made 14 years ago, it's me and two students from the Art Academy in Jerusalem, that explains how ribosomes, bacterial ribosomes work. I incorporated into this movie our results and also results from other labs. Can I get the lights down, please, as it was a minute ago? Thanks. And this is available in YouTube, and for 14 years, nobody complained, which in my opinion says that they are correct, or at least nobody found out that they are not correct. So when the movie starts, here it is. I want to tell you that the Art Academy kids, the artists, wanted the cell to be green, and they thought that messenger RNA has to approach the ribosome. So this is okay with us. All ribosomes are built of two subunits. I didn't say it until now, and I'm saying it now. Small subunit is the decoding place. In the factory, it was the top floor. And the large subunit is where the bond is being made. So here is messenger RNA reaching the small subunit. Look, 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 it takes it. Boop. Boop. Did you see? It took it. And now it is sitting in a path that is made for it. And factors, non-ribosomal factors, that tell the ribosome start and make sure it starts correctly, are monitoring the progress of messenger RNA. So here is initiation factor, one of these three factors in bacteria. Number three, that monitors that step. Now when everything is fine, the first tRNA can be brought into the decoding place by another initiation factor, number two. These are leaving when everything is fine, and the large subunit can progress and meet with the small subunit, produce the ribosome by surface complementarity and bridges, 13 chemical bridges that are being built instantaneously by conformational changes. Now we have the active ribosome, and we look at it from the solution side. So the large subunit is in top, the small in the bottom, and tRNAs are coming in with the amino acids by elongation factors, and the ribosome helps. Come in, being decoded, go out empty. Come in, being decoded, going out empty. Come in, being decoded, go out empty. Very fast. Meanwhile, while this is being decoded, in the lower part, the bonds are being made. So we took away the large subunit. You can just see how the bonds are being made. And you can see also that the newly born protein goes out through a tunnel. And this tunnel protects it, and it is almost as long as the whole large subunit. It's inside here. So the process continues. Now you see the whole ribosome again until the protein is coming out, until the last codon is being read. After the last codon, there is a codon called stop. And then instead of tRNA, there are factors that replace it, like this yellow thing, which are either release or recycling or both. And they bind into this position to the messenger RNA. The two subunits can separate. The protein comes out, can go to where it needs, and the tRNAs can look for the next job. So is the messenger RNA. And that's the whole story. Very simple, isn't it? Took only 20 years minus 2 weeks. Ribosomes are made of many components. In the movie you couldn't see, but now you can see the small subunit and the large subunit. They are made of ribosomal RNA and many ribosomal proteins. I will not explain now every of the components. In bacteria is 50, 60 some, and in human 90. I just will show you, for those that want in a little bit more detail, the small subunit, each protein in a different color, and the RNA chain, which is the most of it. It's ribosomal RNA, 1,600 nucleotides, and with the same, the large subunit. There is a question? No, okay. So let's talk about these guys. You surely know at least Mozart, and Schubert, and Chopin, probably Keats, and Kafka, and Orwell also. Common to all of them, they are geniuses, artists and intellectual geniuses. All died very young, you can see here. All died before or at the middle of last century, 1950. And what you cannot see, all died from infectious diseases. Some of these diseases are not considered killers in our days, or most of them, pneumonia and similar, bad stomach, things like this. What happened in the middle of last century? In the middle of last century, antibiotics came into clinical use. The first one was penicillin that chops the surface of the bacteria, but a very important target is the ribosome. Because of the fundamental role played by the ribosomes, many antibiotics target them. Almost half of the antibiotics are hampering or paralyzing the ribosome. You may know that the natural antibiotics are the weapons that bacteria from one type use to interfere with the cell life of a different species, different microorganism. These are the natural companies improved them, But this is what is being used until today, except for one or two exceptions. The question is, how do the tiny antibiotics paralyze the giant ribosome? So bacterial ribosomes, these are the ribosomes that are the pathogenic, the disease-carrying ribosomes, are of a molecular weight of about 2.5 million, all of them. And antibiotics are less than 1,000, between 500 to 1,000. How does these paralyze that? So the trick is, you remember the ribosome is like a factory. In a factory, stopping, it's an assembly line. Stopping one step is stopping everything. So this is what they do. The antibiotics bind to the functional sites. You see here the skeleton of the large subunit and of the small subunit with many balloons inside. Each balloon describes a family of antibiotics. The original antibiotics and those that were made accordingly by factories, by companies, is the large and the small, and look, all of them bind to functional sites, either to the site of decoding, here, the site of bonding, the site of tunneling through the tunnel, or the hinging, if you remember in the movie, chup chup, this one. Very clever. So instead of talking much, I'll show you another movie that is based on the first one, and it describes four typical antibiotics. And as I said earlier, I didn't expect to be able to do it, but it happened. So here is messenger coming in, and adding doesn't let it go. Doesn't let it bind. You see, you don't have to be large in order to disturb. Just this. The second that I will show is tetracycline, a much more useful one. And it occupies the position of the second tRNA. So it just sits here, and tRNA cannot bind because its position is taken. Can only try, but one tRNA, one amino acid is not enough for a protein. The third one is actually the first one that went into clinical use. It's called erythromycin, and it sits in the tunnel, blocks the tunnel from which the protein will go out. So you can see only very small protein was made, but then it was blocked. That's it. And the last one, from the chemical point of view, is the most clever one, the cleverest antibiotic, called clindamycin. It sits in the bond. Look here. Here is where the bond will be made. Choop! In the bond. The bond cannot be created. So these are four examples, but as I told you, we know now all the ribosomal antibiotics. Now, but there are questions and problems. The ribosomal antibiotics bind to ribosomal functional sites. But what did I say in the beginning? That all ribosomes work almost the same way, maybe exactly the same way. So ribosomal functional sites are highly conserved. They work the same way. And mandatory for clinical use is the distinction between the patient, the ill person, and the pathogen that makes the disease. We want to kill only the pathogen, not the patient. So how does this happen? Even in highly conserved regions, subtle differences can be found, and I will show you one. Let's focus on erythromycin. What you see here is the whole large subunit, the entrance to the tunnel, and erythromycin blocking it, this red thing. We cut the tunnel perpendicular to its long axis. This is the tunnel axis, we cut like this. And we saw the tunnel walls in gray and many antibiotics bound here, all belonging to one family called macrolides, which are the children of erythromycin, and for those that want, the chemistry is here. All these colorful things, each of them is an antibiotic, and each of them was shown crystallographically, experimentally, to bind this way. All block the tunnel. All interact with one of the tunnel components, which I highlighted in pink. It's A for the chemist adenine in position 2058. Let me show you the the way of interaction, erythromycin, and A in position 2058, very, very high affinity here, really love. So this is how the erythromycin binds to all bacteria, all eubacteria, all pathogens. Why doesn't it bind to us? This is highly conserved region. Because even in a highly conserved region, there is a subtle difference, and I want to show you. Please, ladies and gentlemen, pay attention to this point, and you will see the difference between bacteria, this point here, and us. That's all. Bacteria and us. Ah, it's funny, but very important medically. And when there is a G here instead of A, guanin for chemists, there is repulsion, no binding, because it's too close. That's all. Okay, we talked about one problem or one point. Now another issue, much, much more said, is the resistance. Resistance to antibiotics, that is one of the most severe problems in modern medicine. Question is, as I say, it's a problem. It means the pathogens have acquired resistance. How did they do this? In order to understand or to think what to do against resistance, we wanted to understand how it happens. And a prominent mechanism is to modify the anchors that are in the subtle difference to facilitate clinical use. So you remember this was the selectivity rule, A and G. G is already repulsive. This is what they do. They acquire resistance by mutation from A to G. That's it. They can mutate themselves, the bacteria. Bacteria are very clever. Can we combat resistance? That's what we want. But can we? Well, I am not sure. I think maybe we can partially control it. Maybe it's good enough, but combat completely, I don't think we can, because you can see here down, bacteria want to live. Think about it. Bacteria were on Earth before us, before human. They are with us. I don't want to talk about the pessimists that say that they will be after us. So I want to show you just one suggestion that worked. To combat resistance, and this is an antibiotic made of two components. It is a natural antibiotic, the two components that were improved partially. So these are the walls of the tunnel that earlier you could see in gray. This is one component, second component. Isn't it wonderful? The winning couple. They have many anchors here. Each of them is blocking the other part from outside. So this seems to be really beautiful, and look what happened to my face when I read about it. So as a chemist, this is about 14 years. This is called Synersin, and for about 14 years it's in the market. I read about it about 2001 or 2. And I thought, except for starting to have some smile on my face, I thought about chemical combination between the two. Well, I'm not the fastest chemist. Companies and others try to do it themselves and fail because the combined compound was much too large. But we found that not only the combined compound or the two parts of the compound of this new antibiotic are blocking, but also they change the structure of the active site. So owing to the great chemical potential of drug made of two components, we are currently developing a new, less aggressive. What I showed you until now was Synersin, which is aggressive, and we are trying to make less aggressive. We also try to contribute to combating or controlling antibiotic resistance. I want to show you examples. And this comes from the fact that until now, the currently available crystal structures are mainly of models, not of real pathogens. Pathogens are the bacteria that carry diseases. These were found to illuminate common modes of antibiotic action very well, but they do not explain species specificity. It means specificity of specific diseases or the specific pathogens. Some are behaving this way or that way, small changes, but we wanted to understand them. So we also wanted to understand or to find out if there is a possibility to distinguish between pathogens and the microbiome. The microbiome is a very highly investigated yet. This is the collection of bacteria, the good bacteria that we have within us. Trillions of bacteria that are sitting within our body are called microbiome. And they are allowing us to exist more or less. And we can see it while we eliminate microbiome, but also because some of these diverse bacteria have been linked to diseases, diabetics, autoimmune disorder, allergic, and so on. So it's important. And when we are using antibiotic, we are also destroying the microbiome. So we decided to work on a pathogen. Now you see we have crystals of the ribosome from a pathogen. If you want, Staphylococcus aureus. And I want to show you one place where it changes. It's very, very similar to all other bacteria. But there are small changes, and this is a small change. An addition of 8 nucleotides here at the end of part of the ribosome. 8 or 9 additional bases, who cares? There are 4,500, so 10 of them, 9 of them are not important. But when we look at the structure, we see how important it is. For instance, here, the structure is exactly the same. Not because of the addition. But this addition can be a target for antibiotics. And we found 25 positions like this, potential sites, and 16 of them were found to inhibit protein ribosome function. It means they are antibiotics. Just I want to show you where they are on the ribosome. This is the large subunit, face on, and there are these blue things here, and from the side, here. And we are trying now to devise antibiotics that, or new compounds that will bind to them. Almost all of them are busy, either in contacts with the small subunit or with the factors. It means they have functional importance. I want to show you another position, which I'm sure you don't see. It's a sequence of a specific protein, L3, from various bacteria. Here are the names of the bacteria. Here is the sequence. And you can see that only in these four, 2 and 2, there is here something. No. Anybody has a question? No? So let's look at these two positions, this and this, here and here. And when you look at the names of the bacteria, which you can't see, but you can trust me, they are pathogenic. All the rest are not. So this is specific to pathogenic. So we can try to hit them. And I want to show you not what I said earlier, but a similar example, this part. So what you see here is the RNA superimposed of 4 different structures, 2 of them pathogenic, 2 of them are not. And they are the same, so we didn't bother. Next to them, there is a protein. And there are 4 structures here, 2 are pathogens, 2 are not. And you can see that only in one of them, the pathogenic one, there is an additional loop here, which can be a potential new species-specific target. So we are going one by one. And we have now several of them. I can't show you each of them in detail, but the new insights obtained from this high-resolution structure of ribosome from a genuine pathogen provide unique chemical tools for several things. What we wanted is just to understand the properties acquiring specificity, and we got it. But we also got suggestions for novel sites for potential future antibiotics and for improving the clinical performance of non-antibiotics. So not only what we wanted, all this. And most important, for better distinction between pathogens and useful bacteria species in our microbiome, including the natural gut flora, it means we can talk now about something that was not thought about earlier, the design of pathogen-specific antibiotics. So what do I mean by pathogen-specific antibiotics? Design of antibiotic drugs specific for each and every pathogen. In contrast to the current preference of broad-range antibiotics. Broad-range that cut whatever they can, but also the microbiome. So our original goal was to minimize or eliminate resistance. Now we think also about preserving the natural microbiome, which is essentially a revolution in the antibiotic field. So I actually feel that maybe we can contribute something. So before I finish, I want to thank the Weizmann Institute that let me work for years on what was called my dreams. The decision was done by a president that was an immunologist, a biologist, but wasn't changed after he finished his term by a physicist, Chaim Harari. They were encouraged by a scientific advisory committee. I want just to show Alex Rich. Alex Rich tried to work on the structure of ribosomes for years and years, over 10 years. He failed, but he still was supportive. It all started with a very strong and very intensive collaboration with Max Planck in Berlin, with Professor Wittmann, the head of it. The collaboration was on biochemical support, on knowledge, and on the establishment of a research unit for us where we measured the diffraction of the crystals in Hamburg. Professor Wittmann, that all what he wanted is to see the structure of the ribosome, died 10 years before we got the structure. He was first replaced by Franceschi and then by Fuccini. So I had two research groups, and I want to thank all their participants for devotion and determination. The group in Hamburg stopped to work in 2004, it means 11 years ago, always had angels, because the technical assistant said that only angels can work on ribosomes. And the group members came to Israel to the Dead Sea to look for best bacteria, because the Dead Sea bacteria was very essential in our studies. The group in Israel is still working, and it is being run by Dr. Anat Bashan. So here, please, if you want to know who paid and where we measured, it's all written here. But if you want, if you give me a minute, I want to talk to the young female here, young girls, young student girls that hesitate if to stay in science or not, that the society keeps telling them difficult to be a good scientist and a good mother. So let's look at Anat. Dr. Anat Bashan is our senior scientist. She is now working while I'm entertaining you. She's running the group. She is an excellent scientist, and she has 3 children, all of them very nice. Ella has 2 children, and she's also an excellent scientist. Raz, who is now a professor in Ben-Gurion University, also has 3 children. But he doesn't belong here. He's a man. Let's talk about Tamar. Tamar came 16 years ago for 10 weeks. She's still around. Now she has her own three children, and when I took the picture, she had a birthday, and she made a cake. You see the cake? Here is the cake in more detail. Which shows that in my group, ribosomes are considered sweet. I also want to thank my family. My sister is here, but she's not shown. It's my daughter and my granddaughter. They always supported me, although I was not always available for them. And my granddaughter, when I got a prize in Paris, she said, "My name is Noa Ada's granddaughter. As you know, she is a very busy scientist, but she always finds time for me." She wrote it herself, and she even gave me a prize. This is the Nobel Medal. That's not what she gave me. But as important as this is, for me, is her prize. The Grandma of the Year is Ada Yonat. And when I ask her which year, every prize has a year. So this 9-year-old kid told me, "You have to reprove yourself every year. If you fail, I'll take it off the wall." And it's still on the wall. Ribosomes became popular in Israel. He is me. And his wife, you can see her here, is a ribosome. Protein comes out. Even young children are becoming ribosomes. And this is what happened to me. So the artist that made this picture never met me, and he's not a crystallographer. Yet he found the small subunit and the large subunit. And he has an idea for a new antibiotic here. Thank you.
Here from Sergio Valladares. It says, "In our country, the interest for basic science is very low. With your experience in this area, how we can make to change this and motivate children to be scientists?" Well, I want to read it in Spanish now. Dice, el interés por la ciencia es muy bajo en Chile. Y en su experiencia, ¿qué podríamos hacer para cambiar esto y motivar a los niños y adolescentes a seguir estudios en ciencias?
So there is no trick to make children more interested, but I think that some lectures like this that show from the beginning to the end can help a lot. At least this is my experience with young children in many countries. So if you do your best, I understand that all of you are interested in basic science, and talk to the younger people, maybe you can get something. But you also have to talk to your government, or at least to the funding agencies, to fund basic research. So there will be some output in basic research, because otherwise there will not be also new discoveries.
Stand there in the in this for answering the questions. La siguiente pregunta la hizo Francisco Díaz. We are today being witness of a revolution in biology, with the recognition of the great importance of microbiome in the biology of host organisms. In this context, how this? Tienes que mejorar tu letra, Francisco.
Maybe you read it in Spanish.
How we can face this revolution in biology, taking into account the importance of bacteria inside human body and the use of antibiotics, for example?
At the moment, antibiotics do not distinguish between pathogens, disease causers, and the microbiome. So when people take antibiotics, sometimes you feel a bit weak. And the doctors tell you, eat the yogurt, the probiotic yogurt, and things like this. And usually, the microbiome recovers. But that's not a good way to go, because we don't know about usually, we want to talk also about ill people that are ill in other diseases, that their ability to recover is more difficult. So this is why we suggested to design antibiotics that will not disturb the microbiome. This will not happen tomorrow. This will take time, but at least there is some future.
La siguiente pregunta, next question from Carolina Serrano. If you use pathogen-specific antibiotics, don't you have the risk to obtain resistance in the same pathogen fastly?
I don't think that faster than now. And we do have the problem of resistance. This is a problem that we don't have a full answer to, but if we use only for the bacteria that is at the moment the pathogen, we may accumulate resistance in this particular patient, but for similar diseases, it will not work, so it will not spread as fast. It will spread, but not as fast as now.
Okay, la siguiente pregunta de Nicole González. Ella pregunta si se pueden aplicar estos métodos para crear nuevos antivirales. There is some possibility to apply this method in the creation of antivirals that can identify virus, specific viral proteins?
Sorry. We talk about bacteria. Viruses are something else. They don't have ribosomes. They go into the cells and use the cells' ribosomes, and that's completely different game, and I can't talk about it. We didn't do any research in this area.